Okay, so this is the first revision session for strategic management. So in this in the revision sessions, we'll be covering the sessions that we covered after the completion of the midterm. So post midterm, whatever we have done, we'll be covering that in these revision sessions. So similarly, for today's session, we have selected these two topics that we covered immediately after the midterm, that was the Porter's five portfolio analysis and the generic strategies. So let's start with each one of them one by one. We'll try to understand, we'll try to revisit whatever we discussed in the class, and we'll try to just have some more doubts cleared in this. And let's start with this. So first, let's talk about the five portfolio analysis. So now this concept was given by Michael Porter. And this talks about the five forces that any business has or faces at any given point of time, and how much these forces are impacting that organization. Actually decides the kind of success that organization will be able to have in future. So these five, what are these five forces? Let's see that. So these five forces are industry forces that impact on a company's ability to compete in a given market. So the purpose of five forces analysis is to diagnose the principal competitive pressures in the market and assess how strong and important each one is. So these five forces can also be translated or can be called the competitive pressures that any one entity, any one firm is having being existing in a given industry. So what are these five forces? Just we'll try to have a look at that. So this is the Porter's five forces model of competition. So here you see that there are these five forces that we are talking about: the bargaining power of suppliers, bargaining power of buyers, the threat of new entrants into the market, and the threat of substitute products. And in the center, you see the rivalry among competing firms in the industry. And now, we'll try to have a look at each one of these, and we'll try to understand what are these pressures and how do these forces, they can exert some sort of pressure on any industry that is existing, on any firm that is existing in any industry, to analyze the kind of competitive pressure that a firm is having at any point of time. First, we'll try to discuss the threat of new entrants. So the first pressure is the threat of new entrants. Any firm that is existing in any industry faces certain threat of new entrants, and that is that if new firms enter into that industry, then the market share that will be lost from this firm will be the market share that these other firms will gain. So basically, the firms will try to cut out the share that these existing firms are having in the market. So here what I've listed is the barriers to new entry of any firm in any given market. So these are the barriers to entry, that is economies of scale, product differentiation. So the new entrants might not be enjoying the economies of scale that the existing players of the market might be enjoying. So that is kind of a barrier to the entry. So just to get you an overview about this, so the higher the barrier to the entry will be, that means the more restrictive the entry will be, the less threat of new entrants will be. And the lower will be the barriers to entry, the higher will be the threat of new entrants. That means that is that easy to get into this new market, and that makes the threat of new entrants high in that industrial market. So similarly, talking about product differentiation, if the products that are being served by the firms in that industry are highly differentiated products, then it becomes difficult for new entrants to actually get into that market. Then they'll have to match up to the product differentiation that is they are right now offering in the market. So that becomes a threat. That becomes something that reduces the threat and poses as a barrier to the entry. And talking about capital requirement, so new firms will have to incur a lot of capital expenditure to get themselves established in any new market. So that again is a barrier to entry. Then talking about switching costs, So switching cost is something that, for example, you can understand that if anyone tries to offer you some product or services that you're existingly taking from another manufacturer or organization, so the switching cost in terms of switching from one product to the other is something that will make your decision to not switch actually. So if there are a lot of switching costs, like in the case of automobiles or in the case of let's say, or changing your whole, you know, the Apple devices ecosystem, the switching cost is too much. So if you'll try to change from like a diesel based car to a petrol based car, from an Apple based device to an Android based device, there are certain switching costs involved, but that again is a barrier to the entry. Then access to distribution channels is there. If existing players have better access to distribution channels that the new players might not be able to develop, then it poses as a barrier to entry. Then cost disadvantages are independent of scale. Now, if the industry has something that requires you to spend a lot, even if you are not trying to operate on that huge scale, for example, that if it requires lot of research and development expenditure, let's say, so that is actually not dependent on the scale, but it is a cost that is bound with this kind of market scenario. So these kind of things also will be a threat, that will be a barrier to the entry. That is why the threat of new entrants will be low. Government policy can also be restrictive and can also be posing as a barrier to the entry of new entrants. Again, if these barriers that are listed here, if these barriers are high, then the last is expected retaliation. So if these barriers are high, that means the threat will be low, right? So if there is too much economies of scale, if there is a lot of product differentiation, if there is huge capital requirement, if there is heavy switching costs involved, if the existing companies have greater access to distribution channels and privileged access to distribution channels, if there are cost disadvantages independent of scale that are present, all of this, if they are present, that means the threat of new entrants will be low. And all of these, if they are less, then means the threat of new entrants will be high. And in the end, you see expected retaliation. That is talking about the retaliation from the existing people in the market space. So if the kind of market that you're trying to enter into has a lot of aggressive marketing that is taking place in that, so as soon as you launch your product, there is like immediate response from your competition, and then try to readjust your strategies and trying to cut down your whatever is your strategy to capture the market. So expected retaliation again is a barrier to the entry. Now talking about the bargaining power of suppliers. So suppliers exert power in the industry by threatening to raise prices or reduce quality. Powerful suppliers can squeeze industry profitability. Firms are unable to recover costs and wages. Now, suppliers are the people that you are purchasing from, some component that you are using in your product to further sell it to the next party or to sell it to the consumer. So supplier is someone you can assume the role of a raw material supplier. So you're buying from them. So these people are your suppliers. So here we're talking about the kind of bargaining power that these suppliers have. So if there is a lot of they have a lot of bargaining strength with them, suppliers, then what they can do is they can threaten to raise the prices. They can convince you to buy from them at a higher prices, or in the other scenario, they can also threat to reduce the quality. If you want to keep the same price, get it in lower quality, otherwise increase the price. So these kind of things they can do if they have higher bargaining power. And when will they have higher bargaining power? When these factors will be true. Like if there are only a few firms that are in the supplier industry, if these suppliers' products have a very few substitutes, if you as a buyer are not an important customer to the supplier, that means if you're not ready to take their products as per their options, they can easily switch you from another buyer for themselves. Supplier's product is an important input to buyer's product. If the product that you are manufacturing, kind of product that you are buying from them, is an important component, fine. So if you are if you are talking about Uber, fine. Uber is taking the services of Google Maps, fine. So there isn't any good alternative to Google Maps in terms of the the map connectivity and so many things. So that means that Google has a strong bargaining power in that case. So then supplier's products are differentiated, supplier's products have a high switching cost, supplier's poses credible threat of forward integration. Now this point I'll try to explain, rest I think should be sufficiently clear. So supplier poses a credible threat of forward integration. Now when we talk about forward integration, it means that let's say you are in a given scenario in which you're buying from one supplier and then selling it, your product to your buyer. So when the supplier has a credible threat of forward integration, that means that the person you are selling to wants only the product in which the inputs from that particular supplier is used. So if let's say the consumers, they only want MRF tires in your cars. So if MRF wants, they can actually practice strong bargaining power because of that, because it has a strong forward integration, because your buyers are actually wanting that kind of product that is being supplied only from MRF. So these kind of things can lead them to have strong bargaining power. Then you're talking about bargaining power of buyers. Now buyers compete with the supplying industry by bargaining down prices and forcing higher quality or playing firm of each other. Now how do they do that? You just try to do that. So buyer groups are likely to be powerful if buyers are concentrated or purchases are large related to the seller's sales. If purchases account for a significant fraction of supplier sales, if products are undifferentiated. So these are all the conditions in which the buyers will be having a strong bargaining power. Now, when buyers have a strong bargaining power, they actually practice just the. So what are the scenarios in which they can try to do that? Is that if the buyers are concentrated, fine, and if they are buying in bulk, then they can have the bargaining power because they are buying in bulk. So if you are not agreeing to working on their terms, then they can actually switch you with another supplier, fine. So they can change you for someone else that they can buy from, because they have the power, because they are buying in bulk. Now purchase accounts for a significant fraction of supplier sale. Now if you as a supplier, you are selling the major portion of your product to only that supplier and that buyer, then in that case, because if they want, they can make you to work on their terms, the buyers, because if they will retract their business from you, then it can lead you to incur heavy losses, because then you'll have to look for another ways to sell the huge portion of product that you were earlier selling to them. Similarly, these are all the factors in which these buyers can practice strong bargaining power. Now, talking about threat of substitute products. Now, if the products that are existing in the market have certain substitute products, then this is also considered as one of the competitive forces that a firm might have to face. So products with similar functions limit the prices firms can charge. Keys to evaluate substitute product is product with improving price performance trade-offs relative to present industry or product. Now, this can be understood easily by the perfect example of substitute product as we give is the products of tea and coffee. So the kind of services that you're getting or the kind of utility that you're deriving from one product can also almost similar kind of utility can be derived from the other, but they are actually the substitute products. So the amount of substitute products that are available in the market to your product also actually exerts a lot of pressure on you. So if there are more number of products that can be substituted for your product or services, then it creates a lot of pressure. So substitute can be considered in the terms of the railway services, and the substitute can be the airlines. Fine. So if the airlines will be, if the railways will be increasing their prices and the airlines will be reducing their prices, so they'll come in the same price category, and then one might switch. They might not have to be like forcefully be staying with traveling with Indian Railways also. They can switch to the private airlines. So that is the kind of thing that can create a pressure on the firm that is existing in the market in terms of the substitute products or services. Now, rivalry among existing competitors. So this point is talking about if there is cutthroat competition, then that can create a lot of, that can exert a lot of pressure on the existing firms. So when is a cutthroat competition? Whereas when there are numerous or equally balanced competitors, if the industry has slow growth, if there are high fixed costs, if there are high storage costs, if there is lack of differentiation or switching cost, and if there is capacity added in large increments, diverse competition, high strategic stakes, and high exit barriers. So all of these, most of these factors we can put to the perfect competition industry, in which there is not actually the perfect competition industry, but to any industry that has cutthroat competition, fine, that has all the competitors working on the same level and the growth is less. Because of that, they have to just try, whenever they are trying to increase their market share, they're actually cutting that from the other company's market share, because that's slow growth industry. And there are high fixed costs that are involved, and there is high storage costs that are involved. That means that for them to increase their profit, they have to be very agile and competitive, because these fixed costs, high fixed costs and high storage costs, they cannot let them forego that. So because of that, there is stiff competition. There is lack of differentiation or switching costs. So people are easily switching from one product to the other. Because of that, they're always trying to pitch their products as the best product that is available in the market, because there is less switching cost involved. Capacity is added in large increments in these markets. There is diverse competitors. Then strategic stakes are high, and there is high exit barriers. That means that if once a firm enters into this market space, it's difficult for the firm to now exit. So any factors can be given in which you find that the rivalry amongst the competitors is high. This is another type of threat that is faced. So these are the five forces as per Michael Porter. And a firm's competitive position in industry is actually decided by a mix of all of these five forces that it might be facing in one point of time. Now, the second topic for today's revision session is the Porter's generic strategies. So generic strategies, what they are, we'll just try to understand them again. And see, this is just an intro of what was the intent behind giving all these generic strategies. So organizations are trying to sustain and be competitive, and often do that through a set of strategies that they have identified are the most feasible for them. Fine. So it has been given in a book, and Michael Porter has been talking about these generic strategies in his book that was called Competitive Advantage, Creating and Sustaining Superior Performance. These strategies consist of three general type of strategies that are commonly used by businesses to achieve and maintain competitive advantage. So this is what these strategies might look like. So focus actually is being given as one strategy only. So there are three strategies, that is the cost leadership, that is the second one is the differentiation leadership, and focus, that is cost-based focus or differentiation-based focus, can be considered as a part of similar strategy. So that is why you can call them three, or you can also call them four strategies. First, let's see what is cost leadership. So as its name implies, cost leadership allows a competitive edge by manipulating production cost. It does this in two important ways. Charging lower prices to increase market share. This is done by casting the company as low-cost alternative, or reducing costs to increase profits. So with fewer expenses on the books, organization can move. So basically, what cost leaders do is they try to cut on their cost, and they try to pitch themselves in the market as the leaders in terms of giving a better cost proposition, better value proposition. So there can be numerous examples that can be cited for this. Walmart can be one, IKEA can be one. So here the firms, they're trying to establish themselves as a cost leader in the market by providing better value alternatives, the low cost alternatives. And they do that by cutting down their own cost, and they sometimes also charge lower prices to increase the market share. And this particular example can be very much related to the Walmart strategy, as when it tries to keep that kind of predatory pricing just to not lose its market share or increase its market share, even when it is incurring losses. So that is like an excessive stance of this. But generally, they can try to increase their market share by charging low prices. That's a kind of cost leadership. These are the characteristics of cost leader. That is, they have high levels of productivity, they have high capacity utilization. That means that whatever they are trying to be more and more efficient. So fine, so all of these factors can be related to the efficiency. So okay, so all of these factors are talking about the efficiency in terms of like whatever they're investing in, whatever they're spending on, they want that to be translated into some sort of productivity. So that means that they have high levels of productivity, they are using their capacity to full utilization, they use bargaining power to negotiate the lowest price of input. Now, because they are leaders in the industry, they have that kind of bargaining power that they can negotiate the lowest price for the inputs from their suppliers. Fine. So in that case, they have high bargaining power that will fit correctly to the high bargaining power of buyers example from the Porter's five forces. Now, they also have lean production methods. That means they reduce wastage. They have lean production methods and different methods. And they effectively use technology in production process, the access to the most effective distribution channels. They are having everything on point in terms of the effectiveness and efficiency. That's what the characteristics are. Now talking about differentiation leadership. Now with differentiation leadership, the business targets much larger markets and aims to achieve the competitive advantage across the whole industry. Although price is an important consideration on attracting customers, the differentiation methods looks to develop product uniqueness and attractiveness to engage customers. It involves selecting one or more criteria used by the buyers in a market and then position the business uniquely to meet these criteria. Usually associated with charging a premium price, often to reflect the higher production costs and extra value-added features, it tries to give the consumers clear reasons to prefer the product over others less differentiated products. Now, one very good example of a differentiation leader is can be the Apple mobile, Apple phones. So they try to pitch themselves offering something that none of the other competition is offering. They try to give cutting edge technology. They try to be innovative in their product offerings. And then they are also the leader in doing that. Everybody follows the trends that they set up. So that is the difference between a differentiation focus and a differentiation leader. They are differentiating, but they are the leaders in the segment. They have created a new segment that they are the leaders of. So that is an example of differentiation leadership. Now let's look at the next point. So once again, there are a number of concepts involved in this approach, and each one is all about playing to customers' perceptions that might include promoting a product's durability and general utility, which appeals to a customer's sense of value. So they might be charging high prices, but they try to pitch their products, or they try to establish their products in the consumer's mind in a way that the consumer might think that they are getting something more than what they're paying for. Fine. So whatever features they try to put in their phones or any sort of, if you talk about the differentiation leadership, so they try to create a certain air of accountability. That is what is mentioned here. So there is also the notion of brand image. So creating strong brand image actually also works for them. Creating meaningful connections with customers. So the customer relationship management might be very strong. Long-term loyalty support might be there. After-sales service will be very, very strong. Companies that differentiate want to meet customers' unique needs and are rewarded with premium prices. So someone who is actually affected by after-sales service, software support, and different kind of things will be attracted to Apple. Fine. So that is the example that exactly fits here. You can also cite other examples in which, some manufacturer that is offering, super luxurious cars that can be, and that they are leaders in that segment, probably Ferrari or Lamborghini or any hypersports manufacturer. You can actually put in this category. Now, moving on to the characteristics of differentiation leadership. Marketing and promotions team are on their toes. They are very active. They are on the front lines of defining brand and emphasizing it. Then delivering high quality products. Customers won't stay loyal if the reality actually doesn't meet the company's promises. So they make tall promises, but they also try to deliver on that. And they bank on that so that people actually pay money for that. Leading an ongoing research and innovation, they actually are very advanced in terms of research and innovation. And because of that, there's also, this is also one of the things that they actually put in their products, that they're leaders in that kind of technology. Now, coming to the focus strategies. So, cost focus. Here, a business seeks a lower cost advantage in just one or small number of market segments. The business under this strategy seeks a cost advantage in the target segment. The product will be basic, perhaps a similar product to the high prices and feature market leader, but acceptable to sufficient customers. Fine. So here, you can put any example that is sort of a product that is a copy of a product that has been offering by the differentiated leader. Fine. So if you get a car that looks somewhat like another brand's car that is very high in cost, fine, but that is just a replica of that and it is being served in very few markets. Or probably a better example will be, as I've already told, the replica of the Apple phones. Fine, so some Chinese manufacturer might clone the Apple iPhones and then try to sell that. Now, it will not be acceptable to a lot of customers buying replicas of Apple iPhones, but still there is a market for that also. So because of that, these products are often called the Me Too's. Fine. Now, moving on to the differentiation focus. Now, differentiation focus is something that we call a classic niche market strategy. What a niche market is actually a very, very narrow market segment that focused on very specialized needs on a very small set of customers. Fine. So the leader is someone who's providing differentiation, but is a leader in that, has great market share. Fine. But if your market share is very, very narrow, and then you are providing highly differentiated products, that becomes a differentiation focus. So it is a classic niche market strategy. A business aim to differentiate within just one or small number of target market segments. These are the characteristics that clearly identifiable customer needs and want. They exactly know what the customer wants and they're offering just that, exactly that they're offering. Fine. Let's say that a new startup comes into picture, and what they do is they try to sell these e-comic books from let's say the late 90s era, the Indian comic books, and they have created e-books from that, and then they are providing that on let's say subscriber basis. So that is a segment that probably will not have that much followers, but people who are looking for that will be ready to pay for that. That niche market they'll be focusing on, and that they'll be meeting the demands of that market. That is an example of differentiation focus. So that was the revision session for today. So further, we'll have a revision session after this, focusing on the next topic that we have taught. Now, I will be giving a short assignment relating to this also, and some sort of notes also along with this. So if you have any doubts regarding this revision session, you can again contact me on my personal email ID. Okay, so see you in the next one. All the best.